All right, so welcome back. We're running a little late. This time I'll try to stick to time. So let's move beyond statistics now and talk a little bit about physics. Okay, so the way the lectures are structured, we discuss statistics already. We'll talk a little bit about physical models. And then in the remaining lectures, we'll put things together and see where that takes us. And one of the simplest and most intuitive models that has been around in cosmology for many decades now is the spherical evolution model. This is what we'll look at today. But before that, let's just go a little bit beyond linear theory to see what to expect and why we want to look at things like the spherical evolution model in the first place. Okay, so this is something that you haven't yet done, but you will probably be touching upon in Dimitri's lectures in tomorrow and the day after. So I'm just summarizing something here. Don't worry if you've not seen this before, you will see it in more detail. And people who have done basic cosmology courses in linear structure formation should see this as familiar. This is not particularly accurate, but it's a very useful mnemonic way of remembering things. Basically, what one is saying is that in the linear regime, if you focus on sub-Hubble scales, so this terminology is the same as what Paolo has been using and Dimitri. So at sub-Hubble scales, depending on whether you're radiation-dominated or matter-dominated or cosmological constant-dominated, the growth of perturbations is different, okay? Because the equations involve the Hubble parameter. So the Hubble drag term changes in these three different regimes and it changes the nature of the solutions. And in radiation domination, what you will end up with, actually this is, it's a little more complicated than this, but what you end up with is in fact this solution. You have only logarithmic growth of the density contrast. So basically sub-Hubble modes during radiation domination essentially don't evolve. In the distant future also, when lambda starts dominating, assuming lambda CDM, the Hubble constant will become, the Hubble parameter will become a constant. And in that regime also, the density contrast essentially stops evolving. There is a decaying mode which goes away and there's a constant that is left behind. And during matter domination, when the Hubble parameter is changing like 1 over t, 2 over 3t in particular, you have these two linearly independent solutions, one of which is growing with time. Okay. And physically, if you think about it, all that one is saying is that, so the, another way, this is the way I like to think about the physical picture. Basically, there's a second order equation which is determining the growth of these linear perturbations. So you go back to your harmonic oscillator, and you have now a harmonic oscillator in the presence of a drag term here. So what one is saying is that if the drag had not been there, then this is describing instability. Okay, so this is not a harmonic oscillator because there is a force term which is not a restoring force. It is a force which is driving you away from your initial conditions, right? So you have a gravitational instability. And if I did not have this drag term, then the instability would lead to exponential growth. And in the, so this is what you would expect if I just have d2 by dt squared equal to a constant, yeah, a positive constant. But in the presence of the drag term, this exponential growth is tempered and you are left with a power law growth. Okay, so instead of e raised to something times t, you have t to the power something. So this is the kind of solution that you get during matter domination. And radiation and lambda domination are basically regimes in which the Hubble drag is so large compared to the effects of gravity that gravity has a hard time winning. But for the time being, what we basically want to take away from this discussion is that when you're studying linear theory, linear growth is basically a multiplicative factor in front of the initial condition. So suppose I wait a little bit from my initial conditions, I wait for these decaying modes to decay away, then I'm only left with a growing solution. And this growing solution, all it is doing is it's taking my initial condition, delta plus in this case, and multiplying it with some function of time. Okay, so all I care about is, you know, you give me the initial condition, so the statistics that we discussed will go into describing what the initial conditions are like. And then in the linear regime, all that will happen is that these initial conditions will, in the density contrast, will just get multiplied with a time-dependent factor. So the value of the density contrast at any given place will simply scale according to this growth function. Okay, so the power spectrum in particular, because everything is linear, so I can go safely between real space and Fourier space. And this multiplicative factor will just go through. So when I take the Fourier transform of this delta plus, my delta of k will also get multiplied with the same function of time. So when I take such a delta k, and I take its two-point correlation function, I'll have a delta k, I'll have a delta k prime. Each of them will come with one power of the growth factor. So my linear power spectrum at any given time, at a given k mode, will be the initial linear power spectrum at that k mode, multiplied with this growth factor, square of this growth factor now, because the power spectrum involves two powers of delta. Is this part okay for everyone? If there's confusion here, let me know right away. All right, so this is very simple linear statistics as a function of time. Okay, and then you can do, you know, you don't have to look at only lambda domination or matter domination, etc. You can do everything together. And it turns out that the solution for the growth function is given by this integral. So if I know the Hubble parameter as a function of redshift, which I can write down in a lambda CDM universe, then this is the integral I need to solve. And in fact, if nowadays, if you just plug things into a computer, you can do this numerically, just tabulate it and you'll get the answer. You can also, using special functions, write this down in terms of a hypergeometric function, and then there are routines available to calculate these hypergeometric functions. So that's another way of doing it. Or you can use this kind of fitting function, which has been shown to be very accurate. So again, Bernardo physics reports will give you, there's a particular equation which will give you how accurate this is, etc. So you can go and take a look at what all these terms are defined as. And so this is called the growth function. Okay, so this is the thing that that one keeps using everywhere, at least when studying linear perturbation theory, and also in nonlinear evolution, as we will discuss later. And the thing to remember about this is that, okay, by construction, this is normalized in such a way that as I go to higher redshifts, early times, this becomes simply proportional to the scale factor, 1 over 1 plus z. And this is because during matter domination, remember, the growing mode is proportional to t to the 2/3, which is the scale factor during matter domination as well. Right? So the growing mode in matter domination is just the scale factor. So this is constructed so that at early times, this is the scale factor. And at late times, what you can show by just extrapolating this to lower redshifts is that the growth slows down as compared to the scale factor. Okay, and this is simply saying that you're growing closer and closer to this part of the solution where your growth has essentially stopped. All right, so this is the linear theory growth factor. So this is demonstrated here. So what has been shown here is the power spectrum of dark matter from an n-body simulation as a function of scale factor, as a function of wave number on this axis. This is power spectrum versus wave number k. And the different curves are at different epochs. So this is a very early epoch, very high redshift. And as you go upwards and you change color, you come closer and closer to present epoch. Okay, so from very early epochs, initial conditions of the simulation are here, and then you come to redshift zero, which is present epoch here. So there are two things to look at here. Well, several things. One, notice that there is a characteristic shape to the power spectrum in the initial conditions, right? There is this turnover, which Dimitri will discuss. There are these oscillations here, which are very smooth oscillations. These are the baryon acoustic oscillations, left as an imprint from last scattering into the matter fluctuations. There's also raggedness here, but that raggedness is simply because one has generated a specific realization of the initial conditions and measured the power spectrum for that set of initial conditions. Okay, so what you see here is the fact that there is cosmic variance. From realization to realization, there will be some stochasticity because you generated some random numbers. Yeah, so those random numbers have left an imprint here. So that's what has been written here as cosmic variance. These bumps and wiggles here. These wiggles here are actually smooth wiggles. They are baryon acoustic oscillations. Okay, all right. So this is just the shape of the power spectrum, which you will hear a lot more about in the other lectures. What you need to notice here is that if I focus on these small values of k, okay, so 10 power minus 2 and smaller in inverse MPC, the evolution of these, of the power spectrum here, is simply a multiplicative factor. You see that even the noise properties remain identical, Right? So this jaggedness remains identical from one redshift to the next. And all that is happening is that there is a multiplicative factor that is going in. This is a log-log plot, so a multiplicative factor just keeps shifting you upwards by a constant amount. So if I only focus on this part, you see that all the way out to redshift zero, in fact, the shape of the power spectrum has not changed at all, including the noise properties. All that has happened is that I have moved upwards. So this is the regime of linear growth, because linear growth tells you exactly this, that all I am doing as a function of time is multiplying the initial power spectrum, whatever it is. It can be noisy, it can have wiggles, whatever. I take that power spectrum and I multiply it with a known function of time. So that you see demonstrated here. On the other side, at large values of k, you see something else happening. Okay, so initially there is a constant growth. Okay, so at these values of k, for example, you go by the same amount that you're going here, maybe. But then very clearly, as you go to higher and higher redshifts, the shape of the power spectrum is clearly different. Right? So this shape here is very different from the final shape that you end up getting here. Okay, so clearly this is not linear growth. It's not multiplying the initial conditions with a simple function of time. The function of time depends now on which value of k you're looking at. Right? So different values of k are evolving at different rates. The value of k at which this shape starts changing is determined by which redshift you're talking about. So if I look at the initial conditions, there is some shape. Then if I look at these intermediate redshifts, the linear shape is preserved out to maybe k of a little bit less than 1, and then the shape is suddenly different. And then if I look at very large, very low redshifts, I am linear only out to maybe k of 0.1 or so, and then my shape is very different from the linear theory. So basically, this effect of whatever, this is non-linearity because it is not linear growth. So this non-linearity is affecting different values of k at different epochs. Yeah? And it is affecting smaller scales first, and then slowly it is starting to affect larger and larger scales as the universe evolves. Okay, so a little bit more about this. So remember that the k modes are independent in the Gaussian random field, and the evolution is linear during the linear regime. So it's just a multiplicative evolution. So the fact that you don't have multiplicative evolution is also evidence that these k modes must, so now you are not in the linear regime anymore. So you must have nonlinear effects, and these nonlinear effects will actually mix together different k modes. So we'll see this more explicitly a little bit later. But basically this is one other thing that you might infer from this kind of plot. But for the time being, just keep in mind that you do not have linear growth at these large values of k. Okay. So, yes. Can the lines cross each other? Well, no, that is not happening because you have growth everywhere. And in fact, the growth is faster at smaller scales. So the smaller you go, the larger you go in k, the faster is the growth. So no. And anyway, you can see here that the lines are not crossing. And here they are spreading out even more, right? So growth is faster at smaller scales. This is a consequence of hierarchical structure formations. Small scales, they become nonlinear quicker than larger scales in the standard model of cosmology. We'll discuss this a little bit more as well. Okay. So this nonlinear growth is connected to non-Gaussianity of the density field of dark matter. So this slide is basically trying to explain this. So the fact that linear growth is not just a multiplicative factor means that you cannot explain non-Gaussianity at late times using linear growth. So what is shown here are theoretical predictions, which are also compared, they compare well with measurements. Basically, what the plot was trying to show you is that if I plot the probability distribution function of the dark matter field, in the initial conditions, this is going to be a Gaussian because I have generated Gaussian random initial conditions. Okay, so I will have a Gaussian shape. And what was being shown in the plot is that at late times, this probability distribution function does not remain Gaussian anymore. So there is a substantial amount of non-Gaussianity, and the amount of non-Gaussianity we will see as soon as it comes back, it depends on the shape of the power spectrum that you used initially. So the initial power spectrum of dark matter determines how structure will evolve. Okay, so this is what is being shown here. So if I start with Gaussian initial conditions, but with power spectra that are different. One has a steep power, one is a steep power spectrum, one is a flatter power spectrum. So the solid line is for a steep spectrum, dashed line is for a flatter spectrum. Remember things like n equals 0 would be what is called a flat spectrum, n equals minus 2 would be called a steep spectrum from the previous lecture. And you see that the shape of the PDF of the density contrast is quite different from each other in these two cases, and both of them are definitely not Gaussian looking. Yeah, they have long tails for positive values of delta, and at negative values of delta, you cannot go below delta equals minus 1, because 1 plus delta is determining your density, and density cannot be negative. Yeah, so this kind of feature emerges from nonlinear growth, and this nonlinear growth therefore cannot be explained by a simple multiplicative factor, because if I simply take the initial Gaussian random field and I multiply it with a function of time. So what I was saying was that linear growth cannot explain non-Gaussianity, yeah, which is obvious, because I can only, from a Gaussian field, multiplying with a function of time alone is going to give me a Gaussian field. It cannot give me a non-Gaussian field. So something more has to happen. So what I want to now ask is, okay, so the thing that happens, of course, is gravitational evolution. Yeah, so gravitational evolution obeys nonlinear equations, and this is what creates nonlinearity in the evolution, which creates a non-Gaussianity of the statistics of the field. So now there are several things that one can do with these ideas. So one of the things that you can do is to try to estimate at what scale should I stop trusting linear theory. This is called a nonlinear scale, a length scale. Can I come up with an estimate beyond which linear theory will not work? So at larger scales, I expect linear theory to work based on that plot that I showed you. And at small scales, nonlinearities will kick in. So one way of making this estimate is the following, especially for power law or power spectra. So remember, we discussed the variance of density fluctuations smooth at some scale r. So this is sigma squared of r and time. And this is just the expectation value of delta squared, smoothed on scale r at fixed time t. And remember, this is just given by this particular integral with a filter function, w. All right, so now if my initial power spectrum is k to the power n, and my growth function is d of t, then this quantity is going to behave like square of d times r to the power minus 3 plus n. This we saw already in the previous lecture. And you can also convert this into a mass scale by saying that basically a radius r in the initial conditions encloses a mass m, which is proportional to r cubed, because the density contrast is very small. So this is also related to the mass enclosed in this radius r. Now, if you look at, if you do this a little more carefully, what you will find is that if I assume a top hat spherical filter, and I take its Fourier transform and I plug that in here, and I try to do this integral, that integral will only converge for power law power spectra if the index of the power spectrum is less than 1. Yeah, so there's a convergence criterion, otherwise the integral diverges. So we would like to keep n less than 1. Also, I would like to study hierarchical growth, where I have small objects, small scales becoming nonlinear first and large scales becoming nonlinear later, or small objects forming first, becoming merging and becoming larger. This is the hierarchical picture of structure formation. This would require that this sigma squared as a function of r or as a function of mass should be a monotonically decreasing function. And you can see from here that this is only true if n is bigger than minus 3, which means that hierarchical structure formation for these kind of models will take place for this range of n values. So this is an interesting thing to keep in mind. And finally, you can use this idea to ask for this nonlinear scale by saying that let's ask when does delta squared expectation value become order unity? Because at this time, for sure, I cannot assume that delta is much less than 1. So I cannot assume linear perturbation theory anymore. So this at this time, at least, all my linear arguments should break down. Okay. So if I set delta squared equal to 1, and I use this expression, what I will find is that at scales smaller than this kind of behavior with time, I will have non-linearities kicking in. So this RNL up to some constants of proportionality is estimated as a function of time by this expression. So now this is interesting because what it's saying is that if I make n, if I take n to be, let's say, 0, and then I make it more negative, minus 1, minus 1.5, minus 2, then this quantity, because it has 3 plus n in the denominator of the exponent, this quantity becomes a steeper and steeper function of time, a stronger and stronger function of time as n becomes more and more negative. So for a given time, if I ask what is the nonlinear scale at time, you know, 5 gigayears after the Big Bang, that nonlinear scale will be a larger and larger number in terms of megaparsec for steeper and steeper spectra. Yeah? So as I make n more negative at a fixed time, the value of R nonlinear will keep increasing. So this sort of explains the kind of behavior that I already showed you this plot, but didn't spend too much time on it. So this is the result of an n-body simulation performed with different power spectra, different values of n, and all shown at the dark matter density is shown at redshift zero. And what you see is that the different values of n lead to very different structure at late times in these simulations. And it's completely consistent with what we just said. Because what you see is that as I make the spectrum steeper, I go from n equals 0 to minus 2, the sizes of nonlinear structures are visibly larger as you go from this plot to this plot. Right? So these are the same time step in the simulation, but different initial power spectra. And you see that the growth of structure is very different. And then there are interesting games that you can play, because you can also argue that there is a scale invariance in this evolution. So maybe instead of thinking of this as different power spectra at the same time, I could even think of this as showing me time evolution in some sense. Yeah? Because changing n is like changing time. So there's an interesting scale invariance for these power law, power spectra models. But I won't go into this anymore. Okay. All right. So with this preamble, let's talk about the topic of the day. I am not at all sure now how long I have, but I remember that at 5 o'clock you guys have to start. So I'll give you enough time for tea before that. Okay. So the spherical evolution model is a nice model. The nicest thing about this model is that you can, from start to finish, do everything on pen and paper. Yeah, you don't have to put in anything on a computer. It's a fully analytical model. So it's very, very nice for building intuition. So it's very, very idealized, but that's okay. Because as long as you remember where the idealization goes and where the model is expected to fail, you can always keep track of those aspects of the model and then remember that, okay, in this part, I should not trust the behavior of this model. But for other things, it might be very useful. So we'll try to build this up as we go along. So what one is describing is the evolution of a spherical perturbation, okay? So a spherically symmetric perturbation. So I have a sphere which I will draw here. And the idea is that inside this sphere, I have a slightly overdense, initially overdense region. And outside this sphere, I have mean density. So I'm plotting the density as a function of radius. And inside the sphere, I have some overdensity. This is the mean density in the initial condition. So this is the initial conditions. So this is rho initial. I'm plotting rho on this axis as a function of r. And out to this radius, I have some overdensity. And then after that, I have the mean density. Okay, this is rho bar initial, which is the mean density initially. And what I want to do is to ask, how does this sphere evolve as a function of time? So I keep track of the mass contained in this sphere, and I want to follow this mass as a function of time. So what one can immediately almost prove, I will not do it here, but it's very easy to show that for a configuration like this, you will never have mass from inner shells crossing over to outer shells. So there will not be any shell crossing of mass in such a model for this kind of configuration. You can set up configurations initially for which shell crossing will happen. Typically, if you have increasing density contrast, density structure from inside to out, you will have shells which try to overtake outer shells. This is not the case here, which means that what one can do is to simply ask for the radius, this initial radius, which is enclosing all of this mass. You can ask, what is its time evolution? Okay, because it will always enclose that same amount of mass. And that evolution, it's not hard to show, will obey basically Newton's law in the with a cosmological constant, if you like to put in put that in. But without the cosmological constant, this would just be Newton's law, right? So just a minus 1 over r squared force. And you can rewrite that in terms of cosmologically relevant variables, yeah, in terms of the Hubble parameter and the density contrast. You will also note that these are Ravi's slides. He likes to talk about modified gravity. He always compares everything in this particular lecture to modified gravity models. I will not do it, but you can keep reading these notes as and when they come along, and later on we can discuss offline if you like. Okay. So this is the equation that you want to solve. This is something that we've been studying since class 12, probably. Okay, so if I take a piece of chalk and I throw it up from the surface of the Earth, as what is the trajectory? How does the height of the chalk change as a function of time? The equation that you will solve is exactly this one, without lambda, but apart from that, it's the same. Okay, so the solutions to this are also very well known. So instead of deriving this, you derive things on your own. I will just discuss the solutions and some nice aspects of the solutions. So one of the nice aspects of this kind of model is that there is a conserved quantity. There is an integral of motion. You can multiply both sides of this expression with dr by dt, and then you can show that I can integrate that expression, and I will get an expression for a conserved quantity. This is an, you can interpret this as an energy per unit mass of this ball, and this quantity is going to be constant along the evolution of the ball. So for example, if I choose Hubble flow initial conditions, so this is my potential energy, which is just minus gm over r, and this is the square of the initial velocity. Okay, so r dot initial squared, if I assume Hubble flow, then what I'll get is r dot will be h times r. Yeah, so that's why I get h squared r squared here. So this is like 1/2 r dot squared. So 1/2 mv squared is kinetic energy, and it's per unit mass. So it's 1/2 v squared. V has been written as h times r. So for these kind of Hubble flow initial conditions, you can now try to relate this initial value of this conserved quantity with the value at turnaround. Because what one is trying to argue was, you've set up a condition here where I have an overdense region. So this overdense region is going to decelerate more than the surrounding homogeneous universe, because it has a larger density, it has more mass in it, so it's trying to pull itself together. And then what you can show is that at a certain amount, at a certain time, this shell will, or this ball will decouple from the overall expansion of the universe, and it will turn around and start falling inwards. Okay, its radius will start decreasing. So you can ask for the time at which this happens. So the time at which this happens, the turnaround time of this shell, is a time at which r dot is zero. Right? So if I calculate this conserved quantity at that time, then I will only have the potential term, because the kinetic term r dot will be zero at turnaround. And this potential term will involve a radius, which is the maximum radius which this ball can achieve. Because after that, it's going to come backwards and fall inwards. And the mass is the same. The mass is conserved throughout. Okay. So this E at turnaround is the same as the initial E. So now I can play this game. I can write down this equality. And I just do some algebraic manipulations. I divide out by GM. I multiply with an R initial, and I multiply with a minus sign. And this simple algebra will tell you that this ratio of R initial to R max is approximately given by the initial density contrast which I started with. So if I take rho divided by rho bar minus 1, and I call that capital delta I, this capital delta I is supposed to be a small number, that's why I could approximate this quantity with this quantity. But basically what it's saying is that this ratio of initial to maximum lens scales, radii, is completely determined by the initial overdensity of this object. In particular, this ratio does not depend on the radius, the initial radius of the object. Okay, it only depends on the initial overdensity. So I could have started with a very large initial radius, but if I have the same overdensity, then that particular initial radius with that overdensity would have reached a larger maximum radius. Okay, maintaining this ratio to be constant. So this is a very nice feature of the spherical model, that this ratio does not depend on the initial radius, it only depends on the overdensity. And there is a technical aside here that you may not want to work with initial Hubble flow velocities, because you know that realistic velocities, as Paolo will tell you, are related to the initial densities. So you would like to talk about maybe adiabatic initial conditions. Dimitri was mentioning entropy fluctuations today. So you may want to set entropy fluctuations to zero and say that is what is more relevant for cosmology. That's also fine. You can do that with adiabatic initial conditions. All you have to do is that in this expression for E initial, instead of h squared r squared by 2, you have to multiply with this factor, which accounts for this adiabaticity. Okay, so the peculiar velocities will be related to the initial density contrast. Run through the algebra again, assume that delta I is small, and you will again get an expression for r initial by r max, which will be proportional to delta initial. Now there's a factor 5 by 3, which came because of this non-triviality here, but it's a constant. Okay, so for our discussion, it doesn't really play any role. What is again important is that this ratio does not depend on the initial radius, it only depends on the initial density contrast. All right. So now you can, this is setting up the initial conditions, and now you can solve the equations and get the radius as a function of time. And the standard way of doing this is to introduce a fiducial parameter theta, which looks like it behaves like an angle. It goes from 0 to 2 pi, that's why it's called theta, but it's not an angle in any sense. Okay, so there is a particular name for it, which I forget now, but it's a completely fiducial parameter. It's just a way of relating radius to time in an analytical way. So what you will find that the solution is given by this expression. The radius is proportional to 1 minus cosine of this angle, and time is proportional to theta minus sine theta. And theta goes from the initial value of theta to 2 pi. Using this expression, you can write down an expression for the density contrast, the non-linear density contrast now, at any time t. And the way to do it is to simply realize that mass is conserved. So the density contrast is just ratio of density to mean density. So I can write this in terms of mass and mean density times the volume of this ball at any given time. So the volume, the mass is conserved, so it's going to become a constant. The volume of this ball gives you an r cubed in the denominator, right? And the mean density of the universe in matter domination is 1 over a cubed. So that gives you an a cubed in the numerator here. Okay, so this is what the density contrast looks like. And you can run through the algebra again. Once you have the full solution, plug in all the constants. What you will find is that this overdensity, 1 plus delta, is completely determined by this quantity theta. Okay, it does not involve anything else. So all of the initial conditions go into setting the initial value of theta. And thereafter, the density contrast just evolves according to this expression. If I want to know what this is as a function of time, then I need to go to this expression here, which will involve a proportionality factor, which will depend on the initial density contrast again. Okay, so this is what the structure of this equation, of the solution looks like. And another nice thing that you can do is you can simply ask in this model, if I were doing linear theory, then I would know that the growing mode is proportional to the scale factor. We're talking about an Einstein de Sitter universe here, so lambda has been set to zero. So the density contrast in linear theory would be proportional to the scale factor. The scale factor is t to the power 2/3. So you get a theta minus sine theta to the power 2/3 here. Okay? And this will be useful in a bit, because what one is showing here is that here, this is the full solution of the nonlinear problem. So this is the actual answer in this model. This is not an answer to anything. It's just saying linear theory written in the same variables as the spherical model looks like this. Okay, and it will be useful in a second, because what we can now, what I will discuss is, you can directly write then delta as a function of delta linear, and that becomes interesting. So for the time being, this is just a curiosity. Okay. Another comment is that we assume lambda is zero for getting this solution, but you can plug in lambda and ask what happens. Things do not remain fully analytical now. You have to do some numerical work. But it turns out that the effect of cosmology is quite weak. And we'll see exactly how this effect shows up in a few slides from now. Another interesting comment is that I have assumed an initial overdensity here, but I could equally well have set up the problem for initial underdensity. So I could have started with something that does this, then jumps up to mean density and stays flat. This would be the model for an evolving underdense region, a void-like region. And the same algebra goes through with very simple replacements. Basically, trigonometric functions get replaced by hyperbolic functions. Nothing else changes. Qualitatively, of course, everything changes, because now you do not have any notion of turnaround. Okay, and in fact, now you do have a notion of shell crossing, because inner regions are moving faster than the outer Hubble flow. So they catch up with the Hubble flow and lead to a region of shell crossing. So that's an interesting thing which we will not discuss here. You can ask me about it later. Okay. So now let's, so before we move on to the next slide, let's just look at something else interesting that happens here. As I go from small values of theta through theta equals pi to theta equals 2 pi, something interesting happens, because when theta goes to 2 pi, the numerator has sine theta, which is 0 for 2 pi. This theta is 2 pi, so it's finite. But the denominator has cosine of 2 pi, which is plus 1. So I have a 1 minus 1, and this thing is blowing up, right? So what this model is saying is that the density of this ball as theta goes to 2 pi is becoming infinite. This is a clear breakdown of this model, because what is happening in this model is that I have set up a perfectly spherical perturbation. So all the little fluid elements of dark matter are moving exactly radially. Okay, and they are coherent in such a way that they're all, you know, things that are at the same radius initially will be at the same radius at any later time. So everything is moving in and reaching the center, in fact, at the same time. And therefore, my density at the center at a finite value of time is becoming infinite. This is not realistic, because in the real world, you do not expect perfectly radial orbits. You expect some amount of non-radial perturbations as well. And as soon as you have non-radial perturbations, what will happen is that you will have complicated orbit structures. So even if I have a smooth potential with a single particle, which is on a slightly non-radial orbit, I know that from the Kepler problem that it will go into an elliptical closed path. Now I have a bunch of these particles, not just one. Okay, so now, first of all, even imagine a situation where all of these are test particles. I have a smooth potential, and then I let these particles go. They may even be on closed orbits, but the collection of them will be describing a very complicated behavior. It will not be spherically symmetric, at least instantaneously. The situation is actually even more complicated, because the same particles which I am trying to describe, I'm trying to describe their trajectories, these are the particles which are composing the mass of this ball. So the gravitational potential that I'm trying to describe is the potential of the same particles. So it is not as if an external potential has been provided to me. So now the orbits are also going to be extremely complicated. Okay, so what one expects in a realistic situation is that there will be all kinds of phase mixing happening. So my velocities, you know, my particles will interact with each other, and their orbits will not remain closed. They will respond to other particles nearby and so on. And I will reach a situation where I achieve what is called virial equilibrium. So I will reach this kind of kinetic equilibrium, where my potential energy and my total kinetic velocity dispersion balance each other according to the virial theorem. Okay, so this is something that one can assume happens in a realistic setting. It is not part of this model, right? Because this solution clearly does not have any notion of virialization. This solution is going to infinite density at a finite time. So one way of making this model a little bit more realistic is to say that I will not take the results of this model seriously beyond a certain time, and that time I will decide as being equal to the time at which the virial theorem condition is satisfied by the model itself. Because in the model, I know the radius of the ball. I also know the time derivative of the radius of the ball. And I will by hand declare that let's think of this time derivative of the radius as the velocity, as related to the standard deviation of the velocities of a realistic distribution of particles. So r dot squared, I will think of as a velocity dispersion. And if I do that, then I can write down this virial condition. The potential energy is negative of twice the kinetic energy. This energy per unit mass is a conserved quantity in this model. So I can write this quantity as W plus K, which is W by 2 at the time of virialization. So it happens to be equal to this. And I also know from my previous calculation that this same E is equal to the energy per unit mass at the time of turnaround. So that was minus GM over R max. So what this model is now saying is that the radius at which this virial condition will be satisfied is one half of the maximum size that I will achieve. Okay? So let's just look at this in a picture. What the model itself, without doing anything, will do is it will go out to a maximum radius and then fall back to radius zero, where the density will become infinite. And what we are now saying is that we shouldn't trust the model in this region. What we should instead ask is, when does the virial condition become satisfied? That will happen somewhere around here, where the radius becomes half of the turnaround radius. And what we will now declare is that instead of allowing the model to continue all the way here, we will freeze the value of the radius at this value, at half of the maximum. So this is a modification that you introduce into the spherical evolution picture, so as to not have to deal with infinite densities. Okay. So now some other nice things about this model are that you can now ask the question, at what time, at what value of t does this condition hold? This value of t, going back to this solution, will depend on the value of theta at which this condition holds, so that you can figure out. And remember that this constant of proportionality for this relation depends on the initial density contrast. So basically, the time at which virialization will happen depends on the initial overdensity. So if I have a larger initial overdensity, you can show that virialization will happen quicker. Because I have more mass, so whatever has to happen will happen very quickly. As opposed to if I have a lower initial density contrast, then I will take longer for the same kind of nonlinearities to develop. Okay? So my initial overdensity will control the time at which nonlinearities completely kick in and the time at which virialization happens. So now I can turn the question around and say, so you know, this way of thinking is to say, give me an initial overdensity, and then I will tell you at what time virialization happens. But suppose I don't want to do things like this. I live at present epoch. I want my objects to become virialized today. What kind of initial density should I use so that my virialization happens today? I can ask this question. And this will be some value of the initial overdensity. I can calculate this. We will do this in a second. But the point of this discussion is to realize that this critical overdensity, which you will calculate, does not depend on the initial size of the object. It only depends on, you know, the time at which you want to virialize. So if I want to virialize today, then the critical overdensity will be some value. If I want to virialize in the past, the critical density will have to be higher because I need to do all that virialization quicker. But none of that depends on the mass of the objects that I'm talking about. Okay, so let's look at that in a little bit more detail. So going back to the solution, what we want to ask is, what is the nonlinear overdensity at the time of virialization or at the time of collapse? So that calculation is actually quite simple, because I just go back to this expression, this one. Okay, so I ask what happens here at the time of turnaround. So I will use the time of turnaround as a crutch, and I will build up the argument from there. So turnaround happens at theta equals pi. So at theta equals pi, cosine theta is minus 1. Yeah, so this is 1 plus 1, so it's finite, everything is okay. Theta equals pi, sine theta is 0, and theta equals pi here. So what I will find is that at turnaround, at theta equals pi, the overdensity, 1 plus delta, is 9 by 2, pi squared by 8, which is like 5.6 times the background density. Then subsequent collapse and virilization will happen on a scale which is 2 times smaller than the maximum radius, because we showed that R viril is 1/2 of R max. So I get a density which is 8 times larger, right? Because density will go like 1/r³, because mass is conserved. So I'll get a factor of 8 from the fact that my viril radius and my maximum radius are not the same. And what I am calculating is not just this ratio of, so the calculation of the ratio of overdensities involves not only the relation between R viril and R max, it also involves the scale factor. So the scale factor at the maximum radius and the scale factor at virilization are also different, right? So remember, in this expression, I have R here and I also have the scale factor here. So if I account for the difference between the scale factors, that gives me a factor which is, because so the time at which virilization happens will be twice the time at which turnaround happens. So this factor of 2 will be raised to power 2/3, because my evolution of scale factor is t to the power 2/3. And then because I have an a cubed, I will get another power of 3 here in the exponent. Okay. So what I am doing is to argue that if I go from turnaround to virilization, what are all the factors that I need to keep track of? So these are the factors that I need to keep track of. And the final answer turns out to be an object which is 18 pi squared, putting all these things together, multiplied with the background density. And 18 pi squared is about 178. So basically what this is saying is that the final overdensity of my virilized object, firstly, doesn't depend on the mass of the object, because the mass does not play a role here in this ratio calculation. And the answer is around 178, or a factor of order 200 times the background density. So this number 200 is very useful to remember. If I look at an n-body simulation today and I ask, what are the collapsed objects in this n-body simulation? I can immediately start looking at the output of the density field and just look for regions which are enclosing 200 times the mean density of the universe, or the critical density of the universe. And those are regions which are likely to be collapsed objects, according to the spherical model. If you want to be a little more careful, you have to put in the effects of lambda, and that also people have done, and it turns out there are nice fitting functions for this overdensity as a function of omega matter. Another useful thing is to ask, this will be useful for the excursion set picture later. I told you that I can write down delta linear in the same variables. And again, because this virilization will happen at theta close to 2 pi, this delta linear at theta equals 2 pi, if I go back to this expression, I just have to take this and plug in theta equals 2 pi, right? And I will get a finite number. That number will be this, and it's equal to 1.686. So this is again a number which will keep coming up in the excursion set discussion. Okay. All right. So this is a discussion of the nonlinear overdensity in the spherical model. So this is one way of seeing why. These arguments on this slide are a way of realizing how nonlinearities and non-Gaussianities are related in the spherical context. So what we have already seen is that I can write 1 plus delta in terms of that fiducial parameter theta, right? There's a theta minus sine theta raised to something, 1 minus cos theta, etc. And I also wrote down delta linear in this model in terms of the same theta, theta minus sine theta raised to 2/3. So now what I can try to do is I can say that let's assume that that delta linear is small. So I will set up a perturbative expansion for the nonlinear delta in terms of delta linear directly, right? So I will go from delta, so I will take 1 plus delta in terms of theta, but then theta I will invert and write it in terms of delta linear perturbatively. And what you get is this series expansion. Now, one thing that we have not done, and probably we will not do in this lecture series, is nonlinear perturbation theory. Okay, so you will do linear perturbation theory, you have been doing in Dimitri's course. And here we have directly been looking at fully nonlinear models. So there is an in-between step, which is nonlinear perturbation theory, where you say that I will look at the gravitational evolution equations, and I will not fully linearize them. I will keep second order terms as well. Okay, so that's like second order perturbation theory, or I'll keep third order terms. So then that's third order perturbation theory. So third order terms in the density contrast. So if I do this, I will get some kind of evolution equations, which I can then solve, and then I will get some solutions, and I can study them, study the nature of the solutions, and so on. What the spherical model allows you to do is to compare your fully nonlinear model with the results of those perturbative analyses. That is what is being done here. So what we are now doing is to take the fully nonlinear model for which we had the exact expression, and we are perturbatively expanding it in powers of delta L. Okay, so what you see here is that at leading order, you just have one power of delta L, which is good, because if I were in a situation where my linear theory density contrast itself is very small, then all nonlinear terms are expected to be small. So my fully nonlinear solution should be identical to the linear theory solution, right? So in the limit of delta L becoming very small, my fully nonlinear delta should be equal to delta linear. And that is what is happening here. But at next to leading order, I have a 17 over 21 times delta L squared. And now what you can ask is, when I do standard perturbation theory without assuming spherical symmetry, what happens? And it turns out that you can do that, and you can write down the full solution at second order. It will be a complicated solution involving Fourier modes, linear order Fourier modes coupled to each other through convolutions. And what you can then ask is, if I take the spherical average of that second order solution, what will I get? And it turns out that the spherical average, or the monopole of that second order solution, is exactly this factor. Okay, 17 over 21 times this spherical delta L squared. So the spherical collapse nonlinear solution, it already knows about second order perturbation theory in this sense, which is a nice feature. And it's kind of expected. You would expect that a full solution in which you have imposed symmetry should know about the perturbative solution in which you have imposed the same symmetry. So that is all that is happening here. Okay? All right. The other thing that is obvious from here is that this is a real space calculation, no Fourier space here. And I'm getting at second order something that is delta L squared. So if I were to do perturbation theory in K-space, and I wanted to match this expression, clearly I would be dealing with convolutions in K-space, right? Because this is a product in real space. Yeah? So what this is telling you is that perturbation theory at second order in Fourier space necessarily involves mixing together of different K-modes, because I have convolutions appearing in K-space. Convolutions are integrals over K of one delta K with another delta K prime, and then I integrate over K prime. Right? So I'm mixing together modes in K space once I go to nonlinear order. Okay. All right, so that is another command. And finally, you can also invert this expression and get an expression for the linear density contrast in terms of the nonlinear density contrast perturbatively, and this is also useful in practice in several applications. All right. Now, one of the final things that I will discuss and before concluding is that all of this is fine. All of this is exact and nice. So you can, you know, like someone once said, appreciate the aesthetic beauty of this, right? But it's also useful in practice to come up with some simplifying forms which are easy to remember and easy to use. So this is one particular form for the spherical model, which is a very, very good approximation, and it allows you to also think about asphericities in a very nice way. So let's discuss this for a few minutes. So what I'm doing here is to just look at the density contrast, and motivated by this kind of series expansion, what people realized is that you can very well approximate this full density contrast using this expression, where this d linear of time is just the usual growth factor that we were discussing until now. This delta initial is the initial density contrast, which is a Gaussian random fluctuation. And this delta sc is delta spherical collapse. And this is simply this value that we calculated here, okay, 1.686. So notice some features of this model. Okay, and in principle, this value also depends on cosmology, but let's worry about this later. So let's look at this model a little bit. 1 minus delta linear by delta sc to the power minus delta sc. So as delta linear approaches delta sc, this model says that the fully nonlinear delta approaches infinity. This is exactly what the spherical model was also doing, right? What did the spherical model do? I'm going to go back for a bit. This slide. So in the spherical model, this is the fully nonlinear delta. This is the linear theory delta. If I plug in theta equals 2 pi here, this delta L will become equal to that 1.686, which we are calling delta SC. And at theta equals 2 pi, this quantity becomes infinite. Okay, so this limiting behavior for that approximation is the same as the limiting behavior of the full model. That's nice. If I make delta linear go to very small values, then delta will become equal to delta linear, which is the other limiting behavior, which is also very nice. Okay? Now you can ask in the middle what happens. Suppose I didn't keep only linear order terms, if I expanded to second order, then things are slightly different. Okay, so in standard perturbation theory, if I go back to this this kind of expression, there would be this factor 17 over 21. So if I try to match that factor, if I Taylor expand this out to second order in delta and try to match that 17 over 21, and I ask what value of delta SC should I use to get 17 over 21, that delta SC would be 21 over 13, whose numerical value is 1.61. And the delta SC that we are talking about is 1.686. So it's not terribly different. Okay, so even at second order, this model, although it's not perfect, it does pretty well. And another extremely nice thing is that if I compare to another nonlinear model, which is the Zeldovich approximation, which I have not discussed here, but hopefully I will have something to say about it in later lectures. In the Zeldovich approximation also, you can write down an expression between the nonlinear delta and the linear theory delta. And it turns out that there, if I take the spherical Zeldovich approximation, delta SC will be exactly equal to 3. Okay? So this fully spherical model is trying to tell you how to modify the Zeldovich approximation in this limit, by how much you need to modify, by quite a bit. But the fully spherical model is pretty close to standard perturbation theory. Okay, in at least in this approximate sense. Okay, and then the comment about modified gravity, I will not go into. This comment is interesting, it's worth thinking about. 1 plus delta, if I make delta linear go to minus infinity, just as a fun exercise, right? As delta linear goes to minus infinity, 1 plus delta goes to 0. So this is telling you that 1 plus delta going to 0 is sensible because, you know, I have a completely empty region. But that is corresponding to delta linear going to minus infinity. So what does that mean? So think about it, and if you're really confused, you come and talk to me. Okay. This is a cute picture which Ravi made, which you should look at, which is fun. Because this is talking about departures from sphericity. Was there a question somewhere? Okay, so this... Yes. Okay, so this I will not discuss because we are running out of time. So this is what I had to say about the spherical model. You can make things more realistic by making your cows less spherical, okay, and talk about ellipsoidal collapse. And people have discussed this in the literature. We can discuss offline. Let me not go into these details. I think a more interesting discussion, this is the last thing I will say, is why do we even trust anything to do with spherical collapse? Okay, why does this work at all? Because we know that collapse is not smooth, like I was saying before. You expect all kinds of mixing and lumpiness to happen. And the other thing is what the previous couple of slides said, which I didn't discuss, is that collapse is anisotropic. You have to go beyond sphericity to become realistic. So why should you trust anything? So here is an interesting set of results from n-body simulations. So these are 8 halos that were chosen in some n-body simulations, very, very massive halos at redshift 0 in a lambda CDM simulation. And what is shown are dark matter particles inside this radius called R200. R200 is simply the radius where you give me a mass, M, sit at the center of the halo. Somehow I have found the halo. We'll worry about this later. Sit at the center, put a sphere of a radius such that this mass is enclosed with an overdensity which is 200 times the background density. Okay, so grow a sphere outwards until the density becomes 200 times the background density. That is called R200. And the mass of that enclosed density is whatever it is. Now go around doing this for several objects, and what has been done is 8 of those have been picked, which have masses close to around 10 to the 15. Okay? And these are the particles inside R200. This is at redshift 0. Now, because the simulation was run, the simulators know where all the particles were at any given time in the simulation. Simulation was run from some very early time to today. So in the next slide, what is shown is the same halos, the particles of those halos, they have been plotted at an earlier time in the simulation, at redshift 1 in this case. Okay? So the same particles, but at an earlier time. So you see that here the halos look nice and spherical with some substructure inside, which is very, very aspherical in many cases. The overall thing is nice and smooth. Here things have become more dispersed, right? But these are the particles of the halos, corresponding to those halos. And in the blue, what has been shown is the particles which at redshift 0 are in the very, very central regions of those halos. Okay, so basically, really deep inside these yellow regions, whatever particles were there, those have been painted in blue. And this is at redshift 1, and now the same exercise has gone back to redshift 2, so an even earlier time. And again, you see the blue is the things which will become part of the centers of the halos. So what is the purpose of this exercise? The purpose is to show that, okay, there is a lot of dispersion, but the length scales on this plot have not changed. You see, it's always 2.5 MPC. So these particles, it's not as if they are coming from, you know, hundreds of megaparsecs away and becoming halos of size few MPC today. These particles are more or less staying where they are. In the same 5 MPC box, they are living and they are collapsing and becoming halos of a size few MPC. Moreover, if you track the blue particles which are going to stay inside the halos, they are also more or less inside the full distribution. They are not coming from always, you know, they are not coming from the outskirts of the distribution. The things which are outside later tend to come from things which are outside initially. And things which are inside later tend to come from things that are inside initially. So there is a sort of rank ordering built in. Yeah. So basically the centers of these viralized subclumps at early time end up in the center of the viralized halo. It's a very rough argument, it's not exact, but more or less this is what is happening. And the spherical model is very capable of tracking this kind of behavior, because the spherical model says that the time of collapse is related to the initial overdensity. You make the initial overdensity larger, the time of collapse will become smaller. Okay? And remember the initial overdensity, the calculation that we did of the energy per unit mass, E initial, was proportional to delta initial. Okay? So if I make my, or minus delta initial, so if I make my delta initial large, my binding energy becomes that much larger. The total energy becomes that much more negative. Okay? So there is a rank ordering of collapse which is built into the spherical model. Things which have higher binding energy are things which are going to be inside. Things which have lower binding energy are things which are going to be outside because they collapse later. Okay? So that is one nice thing. And the other thing is that although collapse is clearly anisotropic, what we saw is that the spherical collapse picture, when I study it perturbatively, the coefficients that I get are the same as the monopole of the fully aspherical perturbative calculation. Okay, so part of the perturbative calculation is already inherent in the spherical picture. So that is another reason why anisotropies are not playing a dramatic role in breaking the final intuitive picture created by spherical collapse. Okay, so there is another comment about virial velocity dispersions, which let me not go into just now. So let's stop here. And in fact, let's not even take questions just now. Let's just go outside for tea. You can relax before your seminars.